good morning. Welcome to those who have joined us on campus this morning. So glad you're here. For those who are tuning in Facebook Livestream, welcome. So glad that you've chosen to worship with us today. Let's begin with a prayer and ask God's blessing as we share this time of worship together. Heavenly Father, thank you for the gift of this day. Thank you for your blessings of comfort and healing for this past week with so many of our families. Lord, we thank you now for the privilege of worshiping together. And we ask for your blessing as you would accept all our expressions of worship. We say thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, today we're privileged to have the Deaf Signing Choir lead us in worship. And so remember, this is the way that we support and encourage them.
You're welcome to join. You can sign with us, or you can sing, or you can watch. Whatever way you want to worship this morning. Every praise is to our God.
morning, church family.
Good morning.
It's a beautiful day. They've been talking about a 40% chance of rain today. At one point, it was 60% chance of rain. It's down to 15% chance of rain. The odds sound good. So Easter egg hunt is on for this afternoon after a delay. We are needing volunteers. We have some volunteers unable to do it on our makeup day. And so I need to see anybody who wants to work with us on the Easter egg hunt this afternoon, maybe for a few minutes after church, as we work through a few different logistics than what we had planned before. So keep that in mind. I'm going to be looking for you after. So it's going to be an all hands on deck kind of day, because we still want to do this, because it is a way of engaging the community. It is a way of showing our children extra love after they've had some cooped up times. We know that we're in another spike in our community, so we recognize that some may not feel comfortable being here. It will be totally outdoors. I am going to ask that we all have our masks if we're gathering. If you step back and you want to breathe, step back, but any time you cluster, put your mask on. Many of us are immunized already. Many of us have antibodies from having had the cursed disease, but we still want to be respectful as we stand in front of our neighbors and try to provide this. So let's do that today. We'll have the hand sanitizers out. We're going to do everything we can to keep it safe and help your kids to also respect spaces with others. They've got so used to it now. In one event we had with childcare, kids automatically seated themselves 6 feet apart on the curb. And it's like, oh, okay, I guess we've done our job here. And as they counted their candy at Halloween time. So just pray for us today as we do this and try to live the gospel in our neighborhood. Now, should it rain? I'm not keeping these eggs here any longer. I'm done moving them around the building. So we are going to bag them up. So I'm going to still need the volunteers, because we're going to get them bagged up. People can drive by and pick up their bag for an in-house hunt at home. And we will even hand deliver some of these, because I want them gone by the end of today. So anybody who wants to even help do egg bag deliveries, it'll be an egg hunt in the bag. And so we're going to work on that, do it as virtually as we can. We just want to do something for the kids who had to not do so many things this year. So let's work on that together. Let's pray. And speaking of Easter, all around the world, churches adapted, missionaries adapted to whatever the current world situation is. There are many countries in Europe that you have to be over 80 to get your vaccine, or over 70. They're on severe lockdowns. We had nothing like what they've seen in other places in the world. We also have greater access to vaccines here than any place else in the world. So the missionaries still had Easter, and they did it in a unique way in Czech Republic, and then all the missionaries worked together to pull off a nature hike Easter event, where people would, with their smartphones, they would go and scan, and they would go on a hike and follow all of these markers along the way, scan, and the Easter story would be told to them on their phones. So they got the entire story, maybe at 9 stops or whatever, and they would get the entire story of Easter. And many unbelievers helped them even in putting out these markers all over the country. 100 families have interacted with this. The missionaries are, it was, well, 100 volunteers were interacting with this, and it's just all over. People were interacting with the gospel. As they were doing it, one woman said, "I've never heard this story before." Mm-hmm. And it's hard for us to imagine that there's so many people, even in the Western world, who have not heard the story. And if they've heard the story of the resurrection, they've heard it as a piece of folklore, or they've heard it as a fairy tale. They've not heard the truth of the power of the gospel. So everything we do in this church, and everything we do on this property, and everything we do while we're on mission, is that people will know what is the gospel. The world was created by God, and it was perfect. In our rebellion and sin, we became broken, and the world became broken. We can't fix ourselves. We need a Savior. And so, God came to the earth in human form, Jesus Christ. He lived as a baby, a child, as a man, perfect and without sin. And he died on the cross to take the penalty for our sin. And only in receiving this gift can we be restored. I am broken, the world is broken, because of rebellion. But when I raise my white flag and surrender, give it to the one who died for me. Only then does restoration begin and will be complete.
Amen.
And so we will continue to preach that message, the message of the gospel. We need to determine to know nothing among our people here but Christ, perfect, crucified, resurrected, and coming again to save us from ourselves and from our sin. Let's preach that gospel today. The way we live, the words we say, even in this fun little activity we do for the children today. And if you've never heard that message before, hear it today. God loves you, and you aren't hearing this message by accident. You want to know the Savior who can redeem us. Let's pray together. Father, I pray that you'll help us and all the churches, all the missionaries, all the pastors, everybody teaching today around the world, that we will keep first things first. You died for our sins. You rose from the dead. You love us and are coming back for us. And Father, help us to surrender and submit to you today, wherever we are in this journey, in our brokenness, and in our restoration. I pray that we will yield to you today and say, use me today, Father, to let others know, as the ambassador for Christ, how much you love us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Chapters 1 through 3, which we've already covered, basically deal with theology. Don't be afraid of that word. Theology is an excellent word to help us understand what we know and what we believe about God. Now we come to chapter 4 through chapter 6, and this is where the Apostle Paul shifts his focus so that we might know how to practice our faith. It's one thing to know something, but then it's another thing to put it into practice, to apply it to our lives. And so we're going to learn continually the next few weeks from these wonderful chapters, practical ways we can express and live out our faith. Now, Ephesians chapter 4, we begin the story, verse number 7. Chapter 4, verse number 7. Here we go. Now grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of the Messiah's gift. For it says, when he ascended on high, he took prisoners into captivity. He gave gifts to the people. But what does he ascended mean, except that he descended in the lower parts of the earth? The one who descended is the same as the one who ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fulfill all things. So the first thing we see is Paul speaks to all of us of that day as well as our generation, that God gives to us his grace. Remember, God's grace is his unmerited favor. We can't buy it, we certainly don't deserve it, and we can't earn it. We can simply just receive it. And so God promises to all of us when we become a believer, a follower of Christ, God gives to us his grace, and that's demonstrated, manifested in so many wonderful ways in our life. It certainly gives us spiritual insight because we know that God is with us, that God is for us. Now, he ties the Old Testament, you can look up later, Psalm number 68, the Old Testament about God's mighty power, his blessing, and how he demonstrated his love to the people of that day by the things that God would do for them. And now Paul is saying, if we ever wonder, does God really care or love us, all we have to do is reflect and remember all the things that he does for us today. I mean, the fact he's with us, he helps us, and his grace helps us experience at least two things. Now, he mentions two things here. First is God's awesome power. If you remember, when Jesus was teaching, Matthew recorded for us in chapter 16, where Peter was the one who first received that spiritual insight and figured out, by God's help, that Jesus was the Messiah, the one and only true Son of God. And he said, Peter, I'm going to build my church, Jesus is saying, and the very gates of hell will not prevail or prevent it. And so oftentimes we may wonder about the church, and are we losing the war? No. There's nothing the devil can do, nothing the culture can do to prevent Jesus and his church to grow and to thrive. And the second thing with that power is God is present in the gift of the Holy Spirit. All of us, when we become a believer, when we invite God into our life, something wonderful happens. God gives us himself in the person of the Holy Spirit. And so his presence is there in our life. And with that, it helps us practice, live out our faith in some wonderful ways. And so, more than anything else today, I hope you hear from God's word that God loves us and he's with us and he wants us to help us learn how to practice our faith. Now, the word practice, when we think about living out our faith, it's a practice because we're going to make some mistakes. Now, the only one who doesn't make mistakes is people think that the pastor is perfect. There's no way. And yet, many times people look at the pastor in the church, oh, he's perfect. He's got a perfect family. Now, the only one thing I would say is I have a perfect wife. See how she signed that? No, there's no perfect Christian, no perfect pastor, no perfect church. It's a practice. We learn oftentimes through our mistakes. And God is the one who promises to bring good even out of our mistakes and the things that go wrong in our life. And so that's how we learn and experience knowing that God is with us, that God is for us. Now, let's continue the story. Find verse number 11. And he ties the first group of scripture to the second. And he personally gave some to the apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the training of the saints, the work of the ministry, to build up the body of Christ. Now, think about the blessing that God gave to Christ because he was faithful and obedient. He gave the honor to Christ and his church that the only way we can know God is through Jesus Christ. And when we call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we can become a follower, a believer of Christ. Now, with that, God gives all of us the privilege and the opportunity to be a part of a spiritual family called the church. Now, with the church, God does something special for every church. He gives leadership to the church, a pastor, deacons, servants, teachers, workers, those right now, for example, who are taking care of our precious children. What a blessing for all the things that each of us have opportunity to serve the Lord. Now, one thing that the devil often suggests to us is that we're not worthy, perhaps we don't have any talent or ability, whatever, but remember, God gives to all of us at least one gift. And so our assignment as leaders in the church is to help you discover what that gift is and then put it into practice. Now, the church is a practice area. It's an opportunity for us to learn how to use our gifts and with that then prepare for the real ministry that happens outside the walls of the church. And so what a privilege, what a blessing that God has given to our church. First, for me, the opportunity to come so many years ago and to see what God has done over the years, Secondly, the privilege of working with our deacons, our elders, and so many of you who serve in so many wonderful ways. The greatest blessing happens in our church so often is so many people who serve without much recognition. Behind the scenes, we come in here every week and the lights are on, the heat or the air conditioning working, place is clean, smells pretty good. All these things are taken care of, and what a blessing for all of those who take care of that. And so, as leaders that God has given to our church, notice he highlights three things that our leaders, if you wonder, what does a pastor do? What do deacons do? Well, he highlights three main things. One is training the saints. Now, you may not think of yourself as a saint, because we traditionally think of a saint as one who's been martyred, who's given their life for the cause of Christ. But here we can translate this concept, this idea, for the training of the special people. Did you know you're special this morning? Contrary to what the devil would say, every believer in Christ is special. And so it's our privilege as leaders to pray for, to encourage, to minister with you and to you, and to encourage you. Especially when you stumble, when you fall down, we're there. You can count on us to lift you up and to encourage you. What a blessing for our church who gives so many an opportunity. And today, what a special blessing to be led in worship by those who use their hands to share the love of Christ. How awesome the Deaf Sign Choir and our deaf friends. And we're grateful for the church giving them that opportunity and that blessing. There's a place and an opportunity for everyone. But secondly, Paul would say the support for ministry. Everyone in our church and as a believer has a ministry. God has gifted you with something to do. It's a way that you can practice your faith, a way that you can share the good news that God loves everyone. Now, here's the question. Have you discovered what your gift is? All over the years I've been in ministry, there's only one person who said to me, because from time to time we'll give out a little test that helps you discern what's your spiritual gift. And only one person over the years has said, oh, I flunked the spiritual gifts test. And I pushed back and said, you can't flunk the spiritual gift test. We just need to help you find out what it is. All of you have a spiritual gift. The joy and the blessing is for our church is to encourage you to discover that gift, use that gift to honor the Lord and experience God's blessing in your life. And that's the third thing is when everyone is practicing your faith, using your spiritual gift, then it makes our church strong. Now, look at what Paul continues when he says, not only does God give leaders to the church, but look what he says there in verse number 13. Until we all reach unity of the faith and the knowledge of God's Son, growing into a mature man with a stature measured by Christ's fullness. Then we will no longer be little children, tossed by the waves and blown around by every wind of teaching, but by human cunning and cleverness in the techniques of deceit. But speaking the truth in love, let us grow up in every way into Him who is the head, Christ. Now, God has a gold standard, we call it, meaning it's the highest standard above anything else that culture. For example, there's a lot of people outside the church that we encounter who look to the church, look to a pastor, even look to a Christian. And when you and I fail or mess up, we're under condemnation and we receive criticism because the world thinks that the church, pastors, and Christians are perfect. And we're not allowed to make any mistakes. Am I right? Are you with me?
Yep.
Okay. Now, think with me for a moment. God sets a standard that we want to grow up. And oftentimes, some of the greatest lessons we learn is through our mistakes. And so as we grow, who do we become like? Right? Jesus Christ is our perfect role model. If you want to know what God is doing in your life, He's using the good, the bad, and even the ugly stuff of your life to transform you so that you look like Jesus Christ in your character, in your word, in your ministry. And so with that, right, we certainly can look to people and use their example to be like them, but the ultimate standard is to become like Christ in your attitude, in your ministry, your giving, all those things. And with that, that will help all of us see what the world is doing with the gospel. You know, there's a lot of scams and false gospels out there. And because God is with us, He can allow us to see through a false gospel and a false standard. And so with that, that helps us respond by speaking the truth. Now, it's one thing to speak the truth, but you want to do it in love. If you win an argument, and then that person loses out in heaven, what have you gained? And so oftentimes, whether we win or lose an argument is secondary to the fact, do we have opportunity to help that person go to eternity with the Lord? And so with that, what is it that God, as He's working in your life today, does He want to change your attitude this morning so that you become more like Christ? Is it that He desires for you to practice your faith in some special way? Perhaps in your neighborhood? Today, we have a tremendous opportunity to impact our community for those who have come out using these eggs and all the other goodies we're going to give away. It would be a wonderful way to show God's love and practice our faith in ministry to people who become. So, look at verse 16. Paul wraps up this section of Scripture when he challenges us. There's a church for every generation. I want us to think this morning about our church. God has planted us here. He's given us this time. We're in the midst of COVID. All the challenges you and I face. How would we measure our church? A lot of people go to church because of the beautiful building. They like the building. Oftentimes people come and they want to get married. And they come into our building and they go, meh. And so they look for a cathedral or a beautiful setting. And so they're attracted to the church for the building. Now, most churches have some type of building where they meet. But the church is not just the building. Amen?
Yep.
Now, we can do a lot of things to improve and make our building safe and attractive. But there's more to the church than just the building. And so we're grateful and thankful for what God has given to us. 1963. God spoke to the pastor of Harvest Baptist Church. God impressed him that there needs to be a church in Sterling Township, where we currently are. Back then, this was just a huge potato field with lots of broken pottery in the field. I don't know why this became a dumping ground for broken pottery. So, with that, God has raised up a wonderful church. He's planted us here. And so it's not just about our building. Secondly, a lot of people are attracted to a church for their ministries. And God has blessed us with many wonderful ministries. We have the deaf ministry. We've been able, privileged to minister to many deaf friends. With that, God has blessed us to have a daycare and minister to many families who need childcare so they can work. God has blessed us with music and all kinds of wonderful ministries. But the church is more than just ministries. Are you with me? Are you following where I'm going? Can you guess what the real church is? It's the people. So the building is nice. I'm grateful for what God's given us. I'm blessed for all the ministries and the way people are practicing their faith and serving. But ultimately, it's about the people. Would you measure our church, how mature we are, and how we accept and minister and support and lift up people that God sends us? That's what makes a strong, healthy church. Buildings are nice, ministries are great, but ultimately it's the people that God connects us with so that we might minister and encourage and help them grow in their faith for the Lord Jesus Christ. When everybody does their part, look at verse 16. From him, the whole body fitted together and knit together by every supporting ligament promotes the growth of the body for the building up itself in love by the proper working of each individual part. All of us from time to time have experienced some difficulty with one of our parts. Perhaps you've sprained your ankle and it's tough to get around. Perhaps you've hurt your hand and your arm. Any number of things. And when those parts don't work, it's a struggle. And Paul uses this illustration of the body and all the parts working together to apply to the church. And so God gives us a wonderful opportunity as a church. And when every part works to do your part, then we're a wonderful church. I'm grateful for what God has done. I'm excited what he's doing, but even more so, what lies ahead. If you're here this morning and you're enjoying being a part of our church, then praise the Lord. Perhaps God is speaking to you today to become a part of this great church. And we would welcome you to join us. And then all of us together can plan and look forward to the opportunities when this COVID is done and to see what God will do in and through our church. Let's stop here and pray. Lord, we love you and thank you so much for the gift of this property, of this building. Lord, of the people that you have used in the past to provide us for this wonderful place of worship and ministry. And Lord, I thank you for the people that you've called out and raised up to serve in so many wonderful ways. But Lord, now as we think about what you're doing, but I pray if you speak to some this morning who perhaps are ready to become a part of this great church, Lord, you'd speak to their heart and their mind and help them in their decision. And then, Lord, for all of us, we look forward to the exciting things, the possibilities of the future. We say thanks for your resources, for your people, and the fact that you love us. In Jesus' name, amen. Deaf choir going to come and lead us in a song of opportunity, or we can respond. And respond to whatever the Lord is speaking to your heart. So if the fighting choir would come this morning, let's use this time to respond to the Lord. For those on campus, come. I'll be here in the front. Talk to me. I'll pray for you. For those who are watching Livestream, if you'll respond to us. We would love to hear how God's working in your life. Let's give this time to the Lord. You can remain seated for this song.
Hide me from the rain.
Thank you, Deaf Signing Choir, for leading us in worship today. For those who are watching, please let us know how God is working, any decisions you've made, and how we can pray for and minister to you. Thank you for your prayers and support. And God bless you as we enjoy this Easter afterglow and look forward to the egg hunt tonight. So come out and get your share of eggs, because I don't want to take them home with me unless they have chocolate in them. For those on campus, if you'll hang around for a few minutes, there's a way we can pray for and minister to you. Take a moment, grab a card, fill out your prayer request or your decision, and place it in the offering box with your offering. Thank you for your support, and for handing the